Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Don, Keith, Haglund put on Christ, so in Christ may Don be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. As I live, you shall live also. And we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Don Haglund. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. My name is Matt Hadley, and I am the senior pastor here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. And I count it as an honor to be a part of this service of celebration. We have a hymn that we are going to sing, and the story is that this is an old Swedish song that was then translated into German and then translated into English, and Don's relatives used to sing this tune and give the poetry to him in the Swedish tongue. And so as you are able, I invite you to stand, and in your red hymnals in the pews, hymn number 77 is How Great Thou Art. Let us join our voices together in this one.
Thank you.
God who gave us birth. You are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death, and help us to live as those who are prepared to die. When our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. I have a few scripture passages that have been selected by the family, and the first reading is from the Revelation, chapter 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them and will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." And finally, a reading from the 14th chapter of John. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." The words of God to the people of God. Thanks be to God. Don Haglin. Don with two N's. As Eric told me, his father used to like to answer when people said, "Why two N's?" And he would say, "Because three would look stupid." I only knew Don for a little more than a year. He and Alma were actually two of the very first people I met when I came to a meeting, even prior to my coming here as your pastor. And since I did not get to know Don very well over the course of that year that went by so fast, I'm going to keep my comments brief so that those who knew him best can have time to share and to witness. But I'll have memories of Don, how proudly he stood up on Scouting Sunday when we asked everyone who was a scout that had achieved the highest honors to stand, and Don, with his uniform on, stood stood proudly, and we gave him our appreciation. I'm so pleased to see two people here in their scout uniforms. I think Don would smile and is smiling at that. But I will probably always remember being in the front room of Don and Alma's house, holding his hand as he was on the hospice bed, and we had an opportunity to say a final prayer, a prayer of committal, a prayer for the journey that is everlasting and eternal. It's impossible to truly celebrate Don's life without acknowledging some things, and I'm sure these are going to be raised in the open sharing. Nome, Alaska. And we have all of our members here with their work shirts on. What a special place for Don. But teaching. Teaching. Education. Don began teaching at 21 years of age at the Wharton School, and for six decades, he taught. The mediocre teacher tells. The good teacher explains. The superior teacher demonstrates. But the great teacher inspires. A teacher affects eternity. He can never tell where his influence stops. And friends, no one in this room will truly know just how far-reaching Don's teaching has become, as it has rippled outward and outward and outward. But I know enough about teaching to know that you cannot be a great teacher without a commitment to be a lifelong learner, someone who always has the quest to learn and to understand more and more, always seeking further wisdom. The Proverbs in our own Bible says, "Blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who obtains understanding." And just a little bit after that, it says, "Wisdom is a fountain of life to one who has it." Lifelong learners. Surely Don was that. A lifelong learner who has the ability to ask the kinds of questions that need to be asked so that truths and lessons may be unearthed. I'm positive Don learned from his students just as they learned from him. But I want to come back to these questions. If we're going to honor Don's life, each and every one of us here, regardless of our station in life, regardless of our age, needs to be a lifelong learner. And so there are these questions. Questions. What we ask reveals what is important to us. What kind of questions are you asking? What we ask reveals what's important to us. But who we ask reveals someone that we have given authority to, someone who is an authority in this subject. Don was an authority for so many people, and they came to him with questions. As a lifelong learner, I know he went to others, the right people, who have the right information. So if what we ask reveals what's important to us, if who we ask reveals who we see as an authority, how we ask these questions reveals whether we are alive and growing or whether our minds have already died and have started to decay. Do we ask questions with the bravery to hear an answer we may not like? Do we ask questions in such a manner that, yes, I am going to wrestle with this as I seek to get further understanding? Don's life leaves for us lessons. He was blessed. Blessed to make it to 90 and up to the end to have a sharp mind. An inquisitive mind, a funny and beautiful mind, and had passions that he never stopped learning about. we will follow that example. I hope that you will, each and every one of you, be a lifelong learner, especially when it comes to matters of life and death, of faith in Jesus Christ. Because if we are lifelong learners when it comes to matters of faith, when it comes to who Jesus Christ is and how he can be Lord in our life, if we're truly going to do this, we have this promise that if we seek, we will find. If we knock and keep knocking, the door will be open. And if this is our pursuit, then we will be given this incredible blessing, this incredible promise that death is not the end, but only the beginning, and that we all one day will be with God again. Amen. So I told you I was going to be brief so that others could share, and I'm going to ask Eric Haglund, Don's son, to come and to offer up a eulogy for his father.
Really haven't had much time to prepare much for this for a variety of reasons. Lots going on, I guess, but I have had a lot of time to think about it between stoplights and what have you. My dad. Dad was recently selected to receive the Lowell Towns Award. What the Lowell Towns Award is the highest honor that the Explorers Club grants to them. Only a few people get it every year. Four people this year are getting it. All very accomplished people. One of which Prince Albert of Monaco. And then there's my dad. So I can be there for the presentation, but I have the people just stand by. This is a slide of Peter Freuchen. Peter Freuchen is one of my dad's heroes and mentors. He encouraged my dad to go avalanche. He was stuck there for weeks on end with just a hammer. He got out by cracking his leg off his back. And he went on to do further expeditions even after that. The next picture, I'll be using again in Toronto for the award, are several well-known explorers. My dad had this picture in some of his archives. The first one is Captain Amundsen. He was a well-known explorer. The middle one is Ernest Shackleton. And the one on the right is Robert E. Parrish. They were all role models for my dad. The next picture shows what my dad found when he went to the top of the world. A bleak, unforgiving land. some reason, he wanted to keep going back to the screenplay. Next picture is a map. We'll skip that. There's a couple of maps there. Brings us to the idea. Broke his hip the night before he was going to the race. And word got up to the race, and there's not much in Nome. There is a tavern, of course. At the tavern, they put out a poster and put a little note on it, and they said that Don Hagman did not make the race because he broke his hip the night before. And every single his heart was really with the people of the Arctic region. Now, the next picture is another picture of the Iditarod. At the end of the Iditarod, they have an annual golf course, a golf tournament. It's held on the ice. There, of course, I mean, this is over ice. They'll drill holes to put trees down, and they'll play golf balls. And one year he got longest drive, and Dad never remembered that. They must have just did it right that day. Next slide. Polar bears. He loved to look and study polar bears. He would Churchill, Manitoba, that is where you can the migration of polar bears every year. He would go up there many times, not every year, but many times. And I have a neat story about him. They every year they have to take these bears, these great big bears, tranquilize them, and move them out of the city because while they're cute, they'll eat your neighbor. So what they do is they tranquilize them, put them in these nets, and fly them off to out of the city, quite a ways. Danger to people. One year they were having problems with a television crew from Tokyo. Well, my dad, they couldn't communicate because nobody knew Japanese. Churchill. Nobody but my father knew Japanese. Churchill. World War II, he was trained as a Japanese interpreter. So he went up to the Japanese reporters and told them that they had to stand back. And they were so freaked out that somebody, some white guy, knew Japanese that they immediately went back, got out of the way, never be in the way again. kind of a funny thing that when I think of my dad, he's got kind of sorts of like that. So, I think that is it for this presentation that I wanted to go through. Again, it's because it's part of a larger presentation that will go on in October. I mentioned some of my dad's mentors, heroes, if you will. But they have this mentor. My mentor. My best friend. Between kindergarten and first grade, he took a summer job at the University of Alaska and went up there. So that was his idea of taking me up there. It doesn't end there. We went up to Nome, and that wasn't far enough up there. So we hopped a plane. Went 186 miles north of Nome to Kotzebue, above the Arctic Circle. We came back to Nome. I got, at 5 years old, I crossed the Arctic Circle. Then I came back. I went to Head Start there with only Inuit students and myself. Came back. We had a section in first grade about Eskimos, and my first grade teacher insisted that they lived in igloos, and I'm like, they don't live in igloos. Came home to my dad. Said, "Dad, my first grade teacher, she's telling me I'm lying about Eskimos." So he picks up the phone, calls her up, and says, "Can I give a talk for your class?" He doesn't pick up the phone and argue with her. He says he wanted to give a talk for the class. He went to the class. Proceeded to show pictures of Eskimos living in houses in the perfect world, playing in playgrounds, going to normal schools, doing what normal their grocery stores, doing just what people do here. So he found what saved him that one. Anymore, and kind of, yeah, I don't miss her. Or any of her. It's fun.
We would like to give others of you an opportunity to have a short remembrance of a way in which Don touched your life. We have some microphones. You don't need to come up here. If you just raise your hand, either Kyle or Marianne will bring a microphone to you so that we all might be able to hear you. Is there someone who would like to share a memory about Don? We start up here with Lisa.
share this week and then something I will share to Eric. This is from Edna St. Vincent Millay, and I think personally I kind of use literature. My grandfather's cousin was Bernadine Kilty, who was a friend of Isaac Dinesen, and her and her husband started the Book of the Month Club, if you would ever like to check that. This is Dirge Without Music, which has kind of been an issue today. I am not resigned to the shutting away of loving hearts in the hard ground. So it is, and so it will be, for so it has been, time out of mind. Into the darkness they go, the wise and the lovely. Crowned with lilies and laurel they go, but I am not resigned. Lovers and thinkers, into the earth with you. Be one with the dull, the indiscriminate dust. A fragment of what you fell, of what you knew. A formula, a phrase remains, but the best is lost. The answers quick and keen, the honest look, the laughter, the love. They are gone, they have gone to feed the roses. Elegant and gone to feed the roses. Elegant and curried is the blossom, fragrant is the blossom, I know, but I do not approve. More precious was the light in your eyes than all the roses in the world. Down, down, down into the darkness of the grove, gently they go, the beautiful, the tender, the kind. Quietly they go, the intelligent, the witty, the brave. I know, but I do not approve, and I am not resigned. Edna St. Vincent Millay. And I have something for Eric. This is from The Little Prince. On Monday, we will bury Don at, I believe, around 2 p.m., which is kind of fittingly during the eclipse, which he probably will like because he will be eclipsed out of the world. And I believe I am the only person that has beat him at Trivial Pursuit. So I get to win. Okay. And for you, Eric came into my life and sort of brought me back to Mexico, where I lived for 22 years, and I didn't exactly come willingly, because I like the little latitudes, but I did come. I had lost somebody very deep in my heart, but I came with a daughter who I adore, and her name is Alessandra. And Alessandra played with many, many dolls when she was a child, and she had a collection of, believe it or not, 17 Barbies, which I don't really like, but her father, Carlos, was the one who played dolls with her, but there was only one male doll, and he was a prince, and the prince was Eric. And when Eric came into our lives, my daughter also had a big say in how she chose to be her father, and she chose Eric. So I chose something to read to you from The Little Prince, and she has often accused me of choosing literature to make a point. And so I choose this for you, to say goodbye to your father. And at night, you will look up at the stars. When I live, everything is so small that I cannot show you where my star is to be found. It is better like that. My star will be just one of the stars for you. And so you will love to watch all the stars in the heavens. They will all be your friends. And besides, I am going to make you a present. He laughed again. Ah, little prince, dear little prince, I love to hear that laughter. That is my present, just that it will be as it was when we drank the water. What are you trying to say? All men have stars, he answered, but they are not the same things for different people. For some who are travelers, the stars are guides. For others, they are no more than lights in the sky. For others who are scholars, they are problems. For my businessmen, they are wealth, but all these stars are silent. You are alone. You will have the stars as no one else has them. What are you trying to say? In one of those stars, I shall be living. In one of them, I shall be laughing, and so it is as if all the stars were laughing when you look up at the night sky. you, only you, will have the stars that can laugh. And he laughed again. And when your sorrow is comforted, for time soothes all sorrows, you will be content that you have known me. You will always be my friend. You will always want to laugh with me. And you will sometimes open your window. So for that is pleasure, and your friends will be properly astonished to see you laughing as you look up at the sky. And you will say to them, yes, the stars always make me laugh. And they will think you are crazy. It is a very shabby trick that I have played on you. And he laughed again. It will be as if, in place of all the stars, I have given you a great number of little bells that knew how to laugh. And he laughed again, and then he quickly became serious. Tonight, he laughed again. Tonight, you know, do not come. I shall not leave you, I said. I shall look as if I were suffering. I shall not look as if I were dying. It is not like that. Do not come and see that. It is not worth the trouble. I shall not leave you, I said, but he was worried. I tell you, it is also because of the snake. It must not bite you. Snakes, they are malicious creatures. This one might bite you just for fun. But I shall not leave you. But a thought came to reassure him. It is true that they have no more poison for a second bite. It is also true that that night I did not see him set out on his way. He got away from me without making a sound. When I succeeded in catching up with him, he was walking along with a quick and resolute step. He said to me merely, ah, you are there. And he took me by the hand, but he was also worrying. It was wrong of you to come. You will suffer. I shall look as if I were dead, and that will not be true. I said nothing. You understand, it is too far where I am going. I cannot carry this body with me. It is too heavy. And I said nothing. But it will look like an abandoned shell, and there is nothing sad about old shells. I said nothing. He was a little discouraged, but he made one more effort. You know, it will be very nice. I, too, shall look at the stars. All the stars will be wells with a rusty pulley, and all the stars will pour out fresh water for me to drink. I said nothing. That will be so amusing. You will have 500 million little bells, and I will have 500 million springs of fresh water. And he, too, said nothing more because he was crying. Here it is, and let me go off by myself. And now it is time for you to go off by yourself here. And you will always be my friends.
Thank you. Are there others that would like to share something? Marianne will bring it over there to Barb.
I went to one Nome, Alaska trip, and Don did so much teaching to me, I became addicted to the Iditarod. I bought a program on the computer so I could watch it every year. I bought the DVD so I could keep it in my home all the time. When he was in the hospital and broke his hip, I knew that that was going to be a tough Iditarod for him. So with Debbie's help, because I'm not computer literate at that point, and we printed up news bulletins that came across, and at 6 o'clock in the morning, we printed up this, the standings as they were. And he was at Columbia St. Mary's where I worked, so I slipped it in like at 6:30 in the morning on his desk in front of him, and then took off for work. I did that for a few days, and then one day I came in, and he had a flashlight waiting for me. And he said, why didn't you just come and wake me up? And I was like, because it was 6:30 in the morning. He would have talked to me probably about the Iditarod for the next hour and a half, and I would have been late for work. So I kept bringing him for him, and he really appreciated that. We kind of, every Wednesday night live, we would talk about the Iditarod and who was going to be on this year and who was not on and why they weren't on and what happened to those that didn't come anymore. So I'm going to miss the Iditarod.
Others would like to share.
I'm Betty Brandt.
with Doc Hagland two of his field courses back in 1977 and 78, and I think that helped inspire me to, inspired and encouraged me and promoted a lifelong love of travel. And then a number of years after that time, I met Doc and Alma up at annual conference for the United Methodist Church when it met, it used to meet in Stevens Point. And so I didn't know that we had that connection together, you know, at that time.
I just wanted to share a brief memory. I'm from the UWM Department of Geography. I've been a faculty member there for 10 years, which means that he retired before I began. However, I had the privilege of meeting him several times and had the even greater privilege of being able to witness what I thought was an amazing accomplishment. He asked a few years ago, about 5 or 6 years ago, to deliver a guest lecture in a class. And I had a new class on the environment at the time, and said I'd be delighted to have him come in. And he did, and delivered a wonderful lecture on the Arctic, on his experiences, and wove it in beautifully with the themes of the class. And he told me, well, now I can say that I have taught in 8 different decades, I felt very proud to be a part of that moment, and I'm proud to have known Don and to share that moment with him.
What Don taught me is how to treat people. I can imagine him treating the bartender at the Bering Sea Saloon, group of Japanese tourists at the Kotzebue Airport, and the Pope and Prince Fumio in the same way. He was the same person to everyone. And I'm proud to have called Don my friend. He taught me a lot. Okay, I'm one of Don's students, and when I got to be about 40 years old, I thought I'd go back to school, so I looked in the catalog, and I saw this class called Northern Studies, and I thought, well, Sergeant Preston in the Yukon, right? This has got to be interesting. So I signed up for the course. It was a night course. I got into the class. We waited for the professor to come. I'd never seen Don, and a scruffy little professor comes in, and I thought to myself, who is this guy? And as we proceeded through the semester, I started getting out his love of the Arctic, and I started catching on to that sort of thing. And so we spent, 40 years together going up into the Arctic, and we've got all kinds of experiences, like John Welch at the Mackenzie River in a van with 8 students. He was riding along the road as it was being washed out by the river. Up in Churchill on Friday is the day that they have French fries in the cafeteria. So the cafeteria is full of all of these little Inuit kids. It's just crawling with kids because this is the only time during the week they can have French fries. And then Don also liked to talk about his tale of Churchill when he was there when the hotel burned down, right, John? The hotel caught on fire. The school burned down. And this was in the early days. I wasn't with him, but I guess he was out there all night with a bucket brigade, you know, fighting this fire, which was hopeless in the Arctic. So I've got lots of wonderful memories of Don, and I really will miss him.
Thank you, and it's my hope that we'll have one more remembrance, but I hope that many of you will be able to join the family downstairs in our fellowship hall for a meal, and that we will hear more of these stories. So, sir, go ahead.
I was also a student of Doc Hagler for many years. He was undergraduate advisor. He encouraged me to go to graduate school, was chaired my committee, and really traveled with him as a student and a companion through the Arctic for 40 years. The last time was 4 years ago. hoping to go again.
Thank you very much. Why don't we allow ourselves an opportunity? Alma wants to say something? They were going to bring you a microphone, Alma.
And I was with John the very minute he took his last breath. And I am privileged to have had that opportunity as his wife and to wish him peaceful life and death. Amen.
Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need, and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. And so, O God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Don to us, now we give him back to you. Receive him into the arms of your mercy and raise him up with all your people. It is into your hands, merciful Savior, that we commend your servant Don. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive Don into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints of light. We ask all this through Jesus Christ, who knew our griefs, who died our death, and who rose for our sake, who lives and prays for us. And as he taught, so now we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand and to turn in your hymnals to hymn 723, Shall We Gather at the River? To remember that if we dedicate ourselves and our hearts and give our lives to Jesus, that no matter what happens, it's not the end, but the beginning of eternity.